Voron Zero is the smallest 3D printer of the Voron design group. At the time of making this video, version 0.2 revision 1 had already been released. This raises a question. How big is the difference between the versions and is it worth buying version 0.2 or is the previous version good enough? It might be useful to begin by saying what Voron actually is. Project Voron Design was born in 2015 with the goal of creating non-compromised 3D printers that are fun to assemble and a joy to use. What was once a one-person operation has grown into a small tight-knit group of engineers united under a common design ethos. However, Voron Design does not create 3D printers, but only designs them and the designs of the components for them. Nowadays, it's no problem to buy a kit with the parts needed to build one of the Voron's designs. There are currently 5 3D printer designs available. Today, we will take a look at one slightly dusty and incomplete Voron 0.1 kit. Voron Zero is a small CoreXY 3D printer with linear rails, a print area of 12 cubic centimeters and a full enclosure. It can therefore print materials such as EBS and ASA without a single problem. It can print all the parts for another Voron Zero. It can even print on it all the important parts to get the other Voron Designs printers up and running. On Aliexpress, you can buy various modified kits from many sellers. Some kits contain only the most important components, which is basically everything except the Raspberry Pi and the motherboard. Other kits contain the Raspberry Pi, the printer motherboard and possibly other components. There are also kits that will ship a complete puzzle to your home with printed parts. With the release of version 0.2, the possibility of purchasing a kit version 0.1 has dropped significantly. Most of these kits are shipped from China. Therefore, you need to add various fees such as the customs duty. With AliExpress being a marketplace, you are never really sure how good the seller is. So let's take a look at more verified sources. One verified source, for example, is the Printed Solid site. Here you can purchase LDO kits made from very, very high quality components. Basically, this is the Rolls Royce of these printer kits. But you have to pay for the Rolls Royce. Most of these kits contain a lot of upgrades that you will probably get to eventually anyway. The price you see is without the printed parts and without the Raspberry Pi. With Raspberry Pi, the final price is even a little more painful. For a significantly lower price, you can purchase a kit from Formbot 3D. Of course, you can't expect the highest quality components on the market for this price. Still, this is a very high quality kit and probably the most recommended. At the time of filming, the kit for version 0.1 was already sold out. However, the kit for version 0.2 was available and the price was very similar to the price of the previous version kit. If you decide to buy this kit and you are from Czech or Slovak Republic, be sure to watch the Czech version of this video. I'm talking in it about eShop Hotend.cz. There you can buy kits not only for Voron Zero, but also for other Vorons. If you print the parts yourself, you will need ABS or ASA material according to the documentation. The printed parts are divided into primary and accent colors. For Voron Zero, you will only need one spool of each color and you will still have enough material left over. On my temporary modified Ender 3 Pro clone, printing all the parts took a painful 115 hours. I chose ASA from Fillamentum in anthracite gray for the primary color and sky blue for the accent color. I got this filament directly from Fillamentum, for which I thank them very much. Printing with this material was absolutely flawless right out of the box. I can therefore more than recommend it. Be sure to check out the other colors and materials available directly on their eShop. If you don't have the ability to print these parts yourself, don't panic. You can request a print on the official Discord or use the printed forward service. I also bought a few upgrades and accessories for the printer. The first upgrade was a Fitus Voron Dragon High Flow Hotend for faster printing capabilities. A tip to install the M3 threaded inserts that are needed to build this printer. And an axial fan for the hotend since I fried the original one during the build. And also this t-shirt, so everyone on the street knows I am a Voron printer. The dusty kit I was talking about earlier was sent to me by the eShop Hotend.cz. I guess the main point was to give me a taste of what it's like to build my own Voron 3D printer. For this gesture and personal experience, I really thank them very much. The personal experience was really worth it. While this dusty kit contained a lot of quality components, some components, unfortunately, it did not contain at all. A kit from Formbolt should contain all the cables already finished and ready to be plugged in. My kit contained only the connectors and this long cable, but it didn't seem to belong in this kit. From the Voron Zero perspective, for example, the entire Z-axis, including the gear, was missing. Although there was a thermal fuse for the heated pad, there was nowhere to attach it. In addition, this fuse is for a heated pad powered directly from the mains. However, it was not here either. From a Voron 0.1 perspective, there was no usable hot end which the kit is originally supposed to contain. The 0.1 uses a direct extruder and so this screw-in hot end cannot be used. That's why I ordered the Fitus Voron Dragon High Flow hot end. In my case, the flexible steel sheet was only one-sided, as in the case of the Voron Zero. Supplied aluminum extrusions did not match the instructions. Luckily, this wasn't such a problem, as many of them can be used elsewhere. As a cherry on top, I could show the Z-axis motor. As you can see, this motor is slightly touching the table, which is obviously wrong. In fact, my kit contained a motor that was larger than it should have been. I guess that concludes my critique of this kit. But I have good news for you. If you order a kit from one of the sources listed, you will no longer have these problems. At the time the video was published, version 0.1 was almost unavailable for purchase. The build of the wall printer was not difficult. Converted to 4 hours of work on the printer per day, the build took me about 10 evenings. We have to read the assembly instructions really carefully. I had to stop and redo some of the steps several times. I got slightly lost in the instructions a few times. For example, add instructions for placing the nuts in the extrusions for later use during the build. This was mainly because my kit looked like a kit for version 0, not version 0.1. On the instructions for wiring the components to the motherboard, I misread the wire labels. Here was the critical moment when I managed to fry that fan. Instead of 5 volts, I connected it to 24 volts. If you follow the instructions precisely, after you finish wiring, the instructions tell you to install the panels. However, if you install the panels and complete the build that way, you run into a problem. These were the instructions to build the printer. However, you still don't have the operating system installed in the printer control computer and the firmware in the motherboard. To do this, you need to take off the back cover of the printer again and hope that you have access to both memory card slots. The main control software is Clipper. To control it, a web interface is mostly used today. I decided to use the mainsail web interface. The documentation describes step by step the procedure of installing Clipper with the mainsail interface into the Raspberry Pi and the firmware into the motherboard. The procedure to configure the printer parameters is also very well described. The tests of the printer before the first print and the calibration of the printer for best print results are also included. Therefore, I will not bother you with this topic in today's video. If you are interested in any detailed video instructions, please let me know in the comments below the video. Also, don't forget to give the video a like and subscribe to the channel. Being a stubborn person, I expected the printer to print perfectly right after assembly and without any calibration. Of course, my expectation turned out to be completely foolish. Here you can see the print before I did the calibrations. I then did a belt tension calibration and nozzle pressure advance calibration. I also took resonance measurements using an accelerometer. As you can see, the print quality immediately started to look a lot better. These prints are printed at much higher speed than, for example, what the well-known Ender 3 is capable of. I really started to like this printer. With its small enclosed space, getting it heated up was a matter of just a few minutes. Printing ABS and SA was no problem for this printer. Quite the opposite. Instead of dealing with the print cracking issues, I had to deal with cooling issues. I had these problems primarily with fast printing of PLA and PETG materials. For these materials, the solution was to slow down the print and leave the printer opened. Also, the wrong current setting for the extruder motor started to show up. Due to the low current with fast printing, the extruder was skipping. I thought that since I have a printer with such a good heated chamber, I might try some more exotic filaments. The first filament I tried was nylon from Gambert. This material needed to be dried at over 100 degrees Celsius first. As you can see, the printer handled it perfectly. Then I tried nylon PA Jet from Filament PM. Again, the wall print went without a single problem. Next, I tried nylon FX256 from Fillamentum. Again, the result was good. I was quite surprised at how trouble-free printing was from this material and on this printer. I told myself that I could try something more complicated. So I decided to try nylon CF15 carbon from Fillamentum. This is a filament made from polyamide 12, reinforced with 15% of carbon fiber. Printing it on, for example, an open Ender 3 Pro is out of the question. But as you can see, this printer did the job with a straight face. Like every 3D printer, this one is not without flaws. I have come across a few issues while using this printer. Since you built the entire printer yourself, it's up to you how precisely you build the printer. After a few manual pushes down on the Z-axis carriage, the screws on the linear rails carriages came loose. The very poorly designed heated bed holder made it almost impossible to tighten all the screws. I tightened only the screws I was able to reach and ordered a new heated bed holder right away. The part cooling isn't worth much either. However, the biggest problem occurs when printing PLA with the printer closed. There are already several solutions to this, and I will be trying some myself. The plexiglass, or whatever the material is being hurt a lot on this printer. When you print, the PTFE tube draws into the plexiglass on top of the printer. The filament spool also scratches the back of the printer when you print. But far from the worst. When you print materials where you need to keep the inside of the printer hot, the internal stresses inside the plexiglass cause the glass to crack. It doesn't affect functionality, but it doesn't really make you happy. At the beginning of the video, I mentioned the release of a new version of the kit, version 0.2. Probably the most obvious differences between version 0.1 and 0.2 is the shape of the top cover, the LED display, and the skirt around the printer. There have also been small improvements to the extruder and the relocation of the Z-axis endstop. The X and Y-axis endstops have been removed. Version 0.2 uses sensorless homing. In this version, you can also see a significantly improved heated bed holder. But if you are expecting a major change in print quality, you will be sadly disappointed. Both printers print almost identically. Most of the upgrades that are on version 0.2 you can easily put on version 0.1. For a lot of them though, I don't see a reason to install them. We will look at some of the upgrades in more detail in the future. Everyone says how great Voron is. How it prints beautifully and it's a joy to use it. It may be true, but almost no one will tell you how much tears, sweat, stress and swear words are behind it. No one will tell you that unless you do a lot of calibration and different tuning, that it just won't print perfectly. But that being said, you have to build this printer yourself. You choose the colors and actually the components that the printer is built from. The thing is, every Voron is unique in some way. That's actually exactly why you need to do various calibrations and tuning. After the build was completed, I printed on the printer almost every day. At the beginning, mostly for tuning purposes. Now I only print small things on it that I need to print quickly and things where I want to watch the progress of the print. Here you can see the print statistics. I've printed on it from materials and at speeds I didn't even know a machine was capable of until now. I have the printer next to me on my workbench. That way I always have it close to me when I need it. The Voron Zero is a very good printer to enter the world of Voron printers and clipper system. Not only will it let you print exotic materials, but with a few tweaks it will let you print pretty damn fast. These printers are specifically for enthusiasts who enjoy building and playing with printers. If the 12 cubic centimeters print volume is enough for you and the printer catches your eye, be sure to check out some of the links below. I really like the printer and since the printer isn't perfect, I started updating it. How? I will tell you in another video.